want to encourage you in this moment. The words say that his name is power, his name is healing, his name is life. It breaks through the darkness, it shines through the shadows. And if any of those things are things that you're relating to right now, I want you to just claim that Jesus is above those things. If you need his power, he has it for you. If you need his healing, he's got it for you. If you need him to break through those shadows, he's in that place with you right now. And as we continue to sing this song, I just want you to maybe just pray for God to awaken your heart to the reality of that. Awaken your heart to the reality that Jesus is above all of those things. Whatever you're carrying, whatever you're facing, whatever you're walking through, hold on to Jesus. He is your salvation. He is your righteousness. He is your glory. He's the one that lifts your head high. So as we continue to sing, I just want to encourage you to just press in and claim that truth for yourself. Claim that over your life. Shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, and Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy.
Yeah. morning we declare that you reign above it all. You don't just reign above some of it. You don't just reign above a portion of it. You reign above it all. You reign above sickness. You reign above depression. You reign above mental ill health. You reign above sorrow and grief and loss and despair and despondency and disappointment. You reign above it all. You reign above the things we understand. You reign above the things we don't understand. You reign above the things we see, and you reign above the things that are unseen. You are Lord, and you are Lord of it all. You reign above it all. Sovereign over all your works, mighty in power and able to save. Micah 4 says this. It says, in the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as the highest of the mountains. It will be exalted above the hills, and peoples will stream to it. Many nations will come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the temple of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways so that we may walk in his paths. The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between many peoples and will settle disputes for strong nations far and wide. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train anyone for war anymore. Everyone will sit under their own vine and under their own fig tree, and no one will make them afraid, for the Lord Almighty has spoken. All the nations may walk in the name of their gods, but we will walk in the name of the Lord, our God, forever and ever. He reigns above it all. Everything that's taking place in the world today, he is in control of. It's not out of his control or his order. Jesus Christ reigns above it all. And Jesus Christ will return. Can I remind us of that, church? That Jesus came. He's alive forevermore. He's active today. But he is coming back. And one day he will wipe every tear from every eye. He will right every wrong. He will bring justice to every injustice. Because he reigns above it all. And his people will enjoy peace forevermore. We know that we live in a world that lacks peace. And whatever your theology or your ideology of what is going on in the world today, we need to remember that in what we do understand and what we don't understand, Jesus is coming back. And peace is assured for the earth that he created and he will renew. But in this moment right now, we're going to remember those who have given their lives for our freedom. I don't know whether you realize this, if you live on the dark side of the dual carriageway in Nuneaton, or you're from Coventry, or you're from the rural areas, but Bedworth is the town that never forgets. It's the town that has the oldest armistice parade in the whole country, because rightly, I believe, we want to remember and honor men and women who have given their lives for the sake of their country in conflicts gone by. So as we come to 11 o'clock right now, we're going to take a moment of pause, a moment of remembrance, and a moment of reflection, where we remember those who have gone before us to secure the freedoms that we enjoy today. So can I encourage us, if we're not already standing, to stand to our feet for a moment. We're going to have just 2 minutes of silence to remember those who have gone before. 3, son. Greater love has no one than he who lays down his life for his friends. Now, Father, we want to thank you for men and women who laid down their lives for the sake of our freedom. Father, we thank you for that freedom. We thank you for the freedom to even gather this morning without fear or inhibition or limitation because of the price paid for others by others that went before us. Father, we honor you for their lives. We honor you for their sacrifice. But Father, right now, in these days in which we live, we pray for peace across the nations of the earth in Jesus' name. You are the Prince of Peace. You bring a peace that passes all understanding. And Lord, we pray for peace in the Middle East right now. Your word instructs us to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Whatever we think, whatever we interpret in terms of the events of today, Lord, we know that it breaks your heart when innocent lives are lost and when innocent blood is shed. So we pray for peace in Jerusalem. We pray for peace in the Middle East. We pray for peace in Ukraine in Jesus' name right now, that nation that weighs heavy on our hearts. We pray for our friend, Pastor Daniel and Pastor Eugene, other pastors we're in relationship with that are being your hands and feet in those communities right now. Lord, we pray that you would reign above it all. You would bring powers and principalities under your control, and you will bring about peace, reconciliation, and restoration, we pray. Because, Lord, we know that peace will be our future. Peace is our portion. But, Lord, in areas of trouble and conflict today, we pray that they would know something of the peace that ultimately is to come. In Jesus' precious and powerful name, all God's people said, amen, amen, amen. Hey, we're going to take up our offering just as we go back into the final time of worship today. How many people know it's a joy to give to God? Okay, two of us. That wasn't even the 3.5 we normally have. That was two of us in the room. How many people know it's a joy to give to God? That actually our salvation, us being in relationship with the Father, was predicated upon the giving of God. For God so loved the world that he gave. He gave his one and only son so that whoever would believe in him would not perish but have eternal life. We have a God who gives generously, gives freely, gives limitlessly to us. And when it comes to us giving back to God, may we never view it as an obligation, but may we always see it as an opportunity to bring worship and adoration and praise back to him first and foremost, but to also be part of what God is doing through his church here in Bedworth, but also beyond. Aren't you glad to be a church that's making a difference locally? Aren't we pleased by all that God is doing through our Harbour Centre, where over 1,000 people a week come through the doors to have an encounter with Jesus, even when they don't always realize it? Yesterday, you need to know that we were actively reaching our region. We had around 150 leaders from the central area of England being inspired to be all God has called them to be. We're having an impact in Ukraine, in Kenya, in Serbia, in many nations across the earth. And that all comes because of the generosity of the people of God to the church here in Bedworth. So you need to know that giving for us in this church is never a chore. It's never a we have to. It's a we get to. We get to give back to the God who gives to us, but we also get to give and sow in to what God is doing across the earth. So come on, if you're not ready to give, there's envelopes on your seats, there's some ways to give behind me, and we're going to give generously as we worship together. Good to see Steve and Salalila in there. Is Emily with you? Oh, they got married 2 weeks ago, and already there's a separation between them. That's not a good sign. There's a heavy divide. She's on one side, he's on the other. But Stephen and Emily, good to have you in the house. Give these guys a round of applause. Just seeing them then. Great day celebrating with you. We love you. But come on, church, we're ready to give generously. We're going to worship, and then we introduce you to our guest speaker for the morning. Come on. Thank you.
generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to them. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to them. Your name is the highest, your name.
Sing, holy, holy, holy. Church, can we just declare his holiness over and over again? Can we join with angels in heaven? Can we join with saints that have gone before us and just cry, holy, 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 holy? Come on, say that word, church. Just declare it. You can sing it to a tune if you want, but just declare, holy. Holy, 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 holy.
Holy, holy, holy.
we declare that you and you alone are holy. Father, may we never become so over-familiar with the privilege of your presence that we forget to rightfully revere who you are in your holiness. You are set apart from all other gods. You are set apart from all other powers. You are holy. You are holy. You are holy. You are so pure. You are so majestic. You are so beautiful. You are so righteous. You are so different. You are so other that we should never in a million years in our unholiness be able to draw near. And yet through the sacrifice of your Son Jesus Christ, you made a way where there seemed to be no way for us to come in even to the throne room of grace and behold something of your holiness. Behold something of your glory. Because you have even clothed us in robes of righteousness that are not our own. So, Father, we thank you for the privilege of being able to draw near to you, knowing that you don't recoil or stay distant, but you draw near to us. We sense your nearness in this place by your Holy Spirit. And we say, God, do what you want to do. Say what you want to say through your word today that is sharper than any two-edged sword. Pierce, penetrate, bring health, life, wholeness, and vitality to every soul and spirit stood here today. In Jesus' name we pray. All God's people said. Amen. All God's people said. Amen. Amen, amen. Why don't we give Jesus a huge hand of praise, worship. He's good. Awesome. Turn to the person on your right and say, I'm so pleased to be stood in church next to you today. Turn back to the person on your left and say, so you should be. So you should be. Awesome. You can take your seats. Good to be in the house of the Lord, hey? Better is one day in his courts than 1,000 elsewhere. So good decision not going to B&Q, Home Bargains, wherever you could have been today on a Sunday morning. You're in the house of the Lord. It's good to have you here. And it's our privilege and our honor to have a guest speaker with us this morning. Pastor Meshek Manhana is in the house. And Pastor Meshek serves as the church planting director for Assemblies of God, the family of churches that we are a part of. And we now have the privilege of serving on the national leadership team together. So Meshek has been a great friend of ours over the last year or so, becoming a great friend, him and his wife, Charlene, and their four beautiful children. They live in the promised land of Bolton in the north of England. Let me rephrase that. They live in Tottington, which is the posh bit, if you can believe it, of Bolton, between Bolton and Bury. Well, that's where they live, and they serve God at Assemblies of God at the office in Manchester and attend Audacious Church there as well. But it's our privilege and our honor to have you with us, Meshek. You're part of the family, and we want you to feel at home and just share with us what God is urging you to say to us this morning. We're ready to hear, aren't we, church? So let's open up our minds, our ears, our lives, our notepads, our Bibles, and let's lean in. Press into all God has for us today and welcome Meshek as he comes to bring the word today.
Wow, it's great to be with you. Hey, could you just stand with me for a moment, please, if you don't mind? I know you just sat down and you're just getting comfortable and, you know, Oh, Pastor Danny was about to go down and he had to get back up. It's all good. I'm helping him exercise that way. But I just need us to take a moment to just give Jesus significant praise in this house. I need us to understand, there's sometimes where we can get used to just praising Jesus by clapping our hands and maybe just make a few noises here and there. But as I'm speaking, I need you to go back to that place where Jesus did something in your life that completely changed the trajectory of your life forever. Where you know that had it not been for Jesus coming through for you, your life would not be the way it is today. Pastor Danny talked about how we've got 4 children, but actually, for us, there are 4 miracles, because when we got married, we were told we couldn't have any children at all. And we were living in South Devon at that time, and I remember being in this little hospital and sitting down, and as they were about to do an operation on my wife's womb, a panel of 3 doctors with a senior consultant, a GP, and a junior doctor had the junior doctor on that panel just say, listen, before we take her into surgery, can we just do a quick pregnancy test again? Because 7 days prior to that, they had done a full scan on my wife's womb and basically made sure that they'd marked out all the areas to cut out and remove her womb. So now 7 days later, this junior doctor just jumps up and says, can we do a pregnancy test before she goes into surgery? And in that moment, you know, when God is about to do something in your life, he will use the most unusual circumstances. And one of the challenges that we have as people of God is that we come before God with requests and with a preconceived idea of how we want him to fulfill that request. And then when we leave our place of prayer, we go looking for this preconceived idea of how God is going to do the thing that we asked him to do. But I believe God is going to work in the most mysterious of ways in response to the prayer request that you and I are making. And now back into this little room, this junior doctor continued to persist and continued to ask. And now remember, if you know anything about medical hierarchy, you would know that if you're the most junior doctor on the panel, you just do not speak up and say things unless someone is actually consulting you. But this one persisted. And I remember feeling the presence of God in the room, and I knew something is happening. So the consultant just gave in and just said, okay, fine. You know, when you take her out to prepare her for surgery, just do the pregnancy test anyway. It'll just be a couple of minutes. Just get it done and get over and done with. He was now visibly annoyed because this is happening right before our very eyes. So you can imagine he's getting really irritated at this point. And then he said, okay, fine, get it done. Moments later, this junior doctor pops back into the room and just pops her head in and signals to the consultant to come out of the room. And the consultant comes out of the room and comes back in moments later and basically said, look, I don't know how to explain this to you, but right now, I can't explain anything. All I know is your wife is somehow pregnant. And so instead of taking her to surgery, we now have to go back into the baby unit so that we can do another scan. And when they went into the baby unit, we went together in the baby unit, and they put the ultrasound on my wife's womb, and within seconds, we could see there was a baby. And they said, we need to investigate a little bit more to find out how far gone she is. And they did an internal investigation to measure how far gone she was. And remember, 7 days before that, there was absolutely nothing in her womb. And now 7 days later, they measure her and she's 7 weeks pregnant. I share this because I need us to be reminded that we serve a God who reigns above it all. And did you know that he reigns above the restrictions of time? We serve a God who is outside of the restrictions of time. Time is something that he created, and he was outside of the restrictions of time. And I truly believe that there's a prophetic word for somebody in this house who has been listening to the voice of time, that the voice of time has become louder than the voice of the timeless one. And maybe this morning what you need to hear is a reminder that says, the Lord is outside of the restrictions of time. So maybe it has been 5 years you've been waiting for something. Maybe it's been 10 years you've been waiting for something. Maybe it's been even 15 to 20 years. I don't know how long it's been. But all I know is God is outside of the restrictions of time. So for the following months, they kept asking us to come back to the hospital and scan again and scan again and check again. But how many of us know that when a woman is now walking like that, you know that baby is there for real. And by the grace of God, we now have those four miracles. By the grace of God, we now have those four miracles. And some of you in this room, this might be something that you're believing God for, and you've been trusting God for, and you're praying for, and maybe you've received some kind of medical report. But I need you to turn the volume down on the medical report and turn the volume up on the one who is outside of the restrictions of time. And turn the volume up on the one who knows your physiological makeup more than anybody else. The same God who did it for us, it's the same God who can do it for you. Come on, church. The same God who did it for us is the same God who can do it for you. Amen. Do you want to see my family? Can you show them a picture of my wife? There she is. Hey, listen, I know I am punching above my weight, but I'm a man of faith. So come on, you got to give me some credit. That was a faith exercise right there. Like, you know, Lord Jesus, you give me this one. I promise you, I will serve you all the days of my life. And it worked. And you want to meet my children as well? That's little Malia on the left and little Amaris on the right. So that's the first and second born. And then the next one. That's little Malachi. Listen, be careful with that. Oh, you might want to. Yeah, I could tell you stories for days. And the last one, please. Now, that one, listen, that one runs circles around me. She owns me, literally. She can click her fingers, and then this 6'2" guy will come running. So that's the boss of the house. But that's my lovely family. And may you continue to pray for us as we serve. We moved from Southampton just about 18 months ago and moved over to the north. Into the posh part of Bolton, like you said. I don't know about that, but anyway. It's all good. It's fine. Pray for us as we journey this through. And then we're in exciting times in Assemblies of God. Hey, did you know we saw 41 new churches planted since May 2022? To be where we are now, 41 new churches have been planted. So please be in prayer as we see God move across this nation. Now, before you grab your seats, I've given you plenty of time to think about something to praise Jesus for. But as you praise Him, I don't want you to just clap your hands and just make a noise. But I actually want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to mention those things. You know, Lord, I thank you for what you did in 1984 when you did this. Lord, I want to thank you for what you did in 2025 when you did this. 2025? Listen, we are naturally supernatural people. So the prophetic just flows. I'm in 2025 right now. I don't know about you guys, you know. Oh, there's a building in 2025. Jeez, okay. Mention everything that He has done for you. This is the reason why. It's not that you need to remind God of what He did. But as you praise Him for what He has done, you cultivate faith for what you are believing Him to do next. Faith is not a magic trick. It just doesn't happen. It is cultivated. They say the word of God cultivates that faith. But also the word of your testimony, the things that you've already seen Him do, begins to cultivate faith in you. And then now you begin to feel like, okay, right, you know what, God, I am believing you for that house. God, I am believing you for that child. God, we are believing you for that building. God, we're believing you for that healing because of what you did. Are you ready to praise LifeChurch? Come on, one last time. Give Jesus the highest praise in this place. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that even in 2009, when they said my dad would die within a matter of weeks. And I thank you that even when I went to that hospital in London and I, alone without my family, and I decided I was going to go and spend time with him, and I walked in to say goodbye because the doctors had said, say goodbye to you, to your father. But I walked in, Lord, and I laid my hands on him. I said, God, I'm not ready for him to go. And I thank you because even today, he's still alive. You are the God of impossibilities. And Lord, even as we praise him, thank you in this place, I'm asking, Lord, that faith will rise on the hearts of every single one of us. That this house will become known as a house full of faith-filled people. People who dare to believe and dare to expect things that many others wouldn't be able to do. I thank you that when my younger sister was involved in a car crash in 2008, and she was supposed to die on the spot, but somehow you preserved her life. And even though she's paralyzed from the waist down, she is still alive. It is only by the miracle that you did, and you saved and you protected and preserved her life. So how could I not praise you? How could I not give you the highest praise and expect you to do even greater things in time to come? Thank you, Father, even as we get into your word. May your name be glorified. May your name be exalted. I have no desire to speak without you. I need you. Lord, let every heart be open and every mind be alert as we speak to each other and encourage one another in the Lord. In Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Come on, grab your seats. And get ready to jump into the word that we have this morning. The title of the message I was given as I was thinking about preparing to come to be with you today, the message title is Authentic to Christ. I truly believe that in this time and season that we're living in, our world needs a church that genuinely reveals whom Jesus is. Our authenticity is not determined by the communities that we're part of. Our authenticity is derived from Jesus Christ. We are created in his image. We are literally following his blueprint. And one of the challenges that I'm finding as I'm traveling up and down the country is we have churches that are more committed to being authentic to their communities more than they are to Christ. And the challenge with that is we can really become absorbed with getting very relevant to the community that we lose the very assignment that Jesus gave to us as the church. The word authentic simply means to be of undisputed origin. To be of undisputed origin. Now, I'm sure as you are looking through some of those photos of my family, you're potentially noticing, oh, that one looks more like the dad, or that one looks more like the mom. And I have to say, all of the ones that have the colorful personalities that are a bit crazy, that's the mom. Don't tell her I said that. Don't tell her I said that. But there is a real sense of undisputed origin where you see the fruit resembling the originator of the very fruit. Are you with me? And likewise, as the church, I really feel we're in a season where our authenticity has got to become number one priority. Our authenticity to Christ, our authenticity to the Creator has got to become our number one priority. And so we're going to just look through some of that stuff throughout this message as we just journey to follow the model that Christ set. What did he do? If we're going to be authentic to him, we got to be able to examine some of the things, some of the key attributes of his time on earth. We got to go back to Genesis chapter 1 if we need to understand a little bit more of our undisputed origin. Verse 26, then God said, let us, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, make man in our image, according to our likeness, not physical likeness, but a spiritual personality and moral likeness. Let us create humanity in our image. When we talk about being of undisputed origin, we got to go back there. This is the model. We have been created in the likeness of God. Now, we know when we read our Bibles, Genesis chapter 1 is great. Genesis chapter 2 is wonderful. But then we get to Genesis chapter 3 and things go wrong. Humanity fall into sin. And then we get to this classic moment where we see Adam and Eve being kicked out of the Garden of Eden. And then we end up interpreting that to be God is being a mean God. Why is he kicking them out? But we need to read scripture a little bit more and then find out the real reason why he kicked them out. Genesis chapter 3, verse 22 to verse 24. Are you ready?
Yeah.
And then the Lord God said, now these human beings have become like one of us and have knowledge of what is good and what is bad. They must not be allowed to take fruit from the tree that gives life, eternal life, and eat it. Now, pause. God is saying they have fallen into sin, so they are no longer authentic to Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. They are now in a different state, a sinful state. Now, if they partake of the tree of eternal life in that state, you now have humanity for all eternity staying in a sinful state. Let's read on. And it says, gives life, eat it, and what? Live forever in that sinful state. And then it goes on to say, so the Lord God sent them out of the garden. That's the reason. God didn't banish them out of the Garden of Eden just because he's being a mean God, he's having a bad day. He is kicking them out of the Garden of Eden as a protective mechanism to ensure that they will not partake of the tree of eternal life whilst they are still in a sinful state. Because that would make them inauthentic to the one who created them. Can you see how God's commitment to authenticity is far greater than his commitment to our comfort? Are you with me? God's commitment to authenticity is far greater than he is to our comfort. And then it will, because the Garden of Eden would be great for them. that was a comfortable place. That was fantastic. And yet he's saying, I cannot risk, I can't take the risk and leave you there in this particular inauthentic state. I have got to move you out because I have another plan to get you back to authenticity, to get you back to being authentic likeness to your creator. And it goes on to say, so the Lord God sent them out of the Garden of Eden and made them cultivate the soil from which they had been formed. And then at the east side of the garden, he put the living creatures, the cherubim, and a flaming sword which turned in all directions. Why? This was to keep anyone from coming near the tree of eternal life. Authenticity matters to God. This is so important. Even to the point where he says, you're out of the garden. And not only are you out of the garden, I'm going to put a cherubim around and I'm going to put a flaming sword to guard, not the whole garden, to guard the way to the tree of eternal life. Because you are in an inauthentic state. So I need to have a plan. And the plan was called salvation. The plan came in three stages. Number one, for those who will believe in the Son, Jesus Christ, you will be justified, you will be saved. Bang, justification, give your life to Jesus. Today, you're justified just as though you never sinned. Bang, instant. And then it goes into the next stage called sanctification, which simply means the process of removing the power of sin over our lives. Do you know, some of us would remember the day we got saved, and yet when we went back home, some of the challenges we were experiencing earlier on were sort of still there. And you're thinking, but hang on a minute, I got saved. Well, you got saved, you're justified, but now you're in this season where the power of sin, the power of the thing that was holding you, is getting weakened and removed as you now feed on the truth of God's word. And now God is thinking there's this great plan to bring us back into authenticity. Are you with me? And then the last stage is what is known as glorification. That's where you're removed from the presence of sin. And the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And we use language like our brother or sister has been glorified. All of this is because God is committed to authenticity. He's not committed to just our presence in the room and our presence as the church or even our participation. All of that is wonderful. It is great. But if there is no authenticity in us that resembles him, we're still missing the point. Are you with me? So if I were to put it in a nutshell, this is what I truly believe we have to do today. Are you with me?
Yeah.
To live our lives in such a way that people can connect the voice of God and the message of the gospel with the touch of our lives. Let that sink in. You and I are being asked to live our lives in such a way that people can connect the voice of God and the message of the gospel with a touch of our lives. That means you don't need to pretend to be somebody else. You can remain you because there is space in the message of the gospel that can be communicated through you and through me. And in spite of our differences, we both convey the essence of what God is trying to communicate across the whole nation. So if you're taking notes, to be an authentic Christ follower, we have got to make a significant commitment to transformation, not conforming. That's very important. When we look at the life of Jesus Christ, it was hallmarked with transformation and not conforming. And now this is what we're about. This is who we are. We are a people who are to live faithfully committed to transformation. But unfortunately today there's a lot of conforming. And yet Jesus is looking for a church, and Jesus is looking for you and me to become a people of transformation. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says this. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. And the old is gone. Behold, the new has come. I want to just zone in on two words. In Christ. In Christ. In the language that the Bible was written, those two particular words talk about being in an unshakable state when it comes to your position in Christ. And I know sometimes life happens, things go wrong, and maybe our standing in Christ can be waved, can be shaken sometimes, but when we are in Christ, the expectation in the word here is you have taken an immovable position. That no matter what happens on my left and no matter what happens on my right, I am in Christ. No matter the chaos in the nation, no matter the chaos in the nations of the world, I am in Christ. Things might not be going well right now in my family. Things might not be going well right now in my own body. But I am in Christ. Because Jesus modeled the same thing. Regardless of what he was faced with all around the time that he lived, he never wavered. Even in the moment where we read of him in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he says, Lord, may this cup pass me by. This is a vulnerable moment for him, but watch what he says. The very next moment he says, well, but not my will. I mean, not my will, but yours. This is painful. This is difficult. This is challenging. But not my will, but yours. Such is the commitment he had to the cause of our salvation. And then he says, now that I've done this, Life Church Bedworth, are we committed to the cause of facilitating transformation to other people around us? Oh, are we committed to facilitating transformation? I remember when I was in year 10, that was about last year, so yeah. And I went through this time where the power of the Holy Spirit really touched my life. And every night before I went to bed, I would say, God, give me dreams concerning some of the students, some of the pupils at school. Because I recognize that they're not going to listen to me if I just open the Bible and try and read the Bible to them. But I know they will listen if there is something of the supernatural that is being revealed through me to them. And I want to speak to the young people in the house. And by the way, your young people are amazing. I met most of them at Thrive Summer Camp. And my goodness, we had a blast. They're the reason why I wanted to come up here. And I want to encourage you to really begin to expect the supernatural power of God to move through you. It's not for the moms and dads and your granddads and your grandmas. No, no, no. It is for every single one of you. Because if we're going to be authentic to Christ, isn't it amazing that every time Christ would now say to the disciples, hey, let us go into town and see what happens. Every time they went out somewhere together, something always happened. That is because there was an active reality of the supernatural living in him. And likewise, the very same power that Jesus was moving in and continues to move in and live in, we have access to. But maybe church has now just become a lot more about organizational structures and a lot more about our infrastructures and a lot more about every other structure that we have neglected the pursuit of the Spirit of God. All of those things need to be done, granted. But the pursuit of authenticity to Christ is important. So what would it look like? Imagine, just take a moment. Imagine with me. Imagine you went to bed tonight and you said, Lord, do you know my friend Beth is going through this particular situation? Just show me something. You know what's going on in John's life, Jack's life. But I just want you to use me to help them. And if you want your friend to come to church, I promise you, when you facilitate the moment where they can experience the power of God real time through you, they will come running to church. Yeah. And it's not beyond any of you. Yeah, we all have it. Yeah. It's not because you're holding a microphone. Forget that. It's a heart that is hungry, that says, God, use me. If you're looking for somebody to use in our school, in my school, you got me. Yeah. Use me. Transformation, not conforming. Romans chapter 12 is a classic scripture that helps us to understand a little bit there. And it basically just, in actual fact, before we go there, let's pause. Before we go there, I really feel I need to lean into this a little bit more. Which areas of our lives have we begun to conform and neglected transformation? Maybe you're taking notes. Maybe write those things down. It's okay. Write those things down. You're being vulnerable before God and say, Lord, you know what? I neglected transformation in this area, and I've just found myself conforming a lot in this particular area. But I'm writing it down because I want to be vulnerable before you, and I'm bringing it to you to say, Lord, I'm making a fresh commitment today to transformation, because I recognize that if I'm going to be somebody that you're going to use to impact my community, to impact the nation, I need to be an agent of transformation, not conforming. Now, I'm not saying let's be law, let's break the law and do, no, I'm talking about revealing Jesus, revealing the power and the authority and the presence of Jesus in our lives. Transforming, not conforming. That's very, very important. Point number two. Oh, man. Okay. I can't go to point number two yet. I have to stay here. Romans 12, let's go back. What does it say? Therefore, I urge you. Are you okay with me doing this? Yeah. This is me being at home. So it might be a bit messy. It might be like a bit crazy. That's what family is like, right? Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to what? To present your bodies, dedicating all of yourselves, being set apart as a living sacrifice. In other words, laying our lives down. And then he goes on to say, you're being holy and well-pleasing to God, which is your rational, logical, or intelligent act of worship. Other version says that's your reasonable act of worship. And then the second part, and do not be conformed to this world any longer, with its superficial values and customs, but be transformed and progressively changed as you mature spiritually. How? By the renewing of your mind, focusing on godly values and ethical attitudes, so that you may prove for yourselves what the will of God is in any circumstance, that which is good and acceptable and perfect in his plan and purposes for you. I need to just zone in on a couple of things. Number one, your life is a living sacrifice. If we're going to be transformed and not conforming, there has to be a moment where you and I say, God, as for this guy, I'm giving myself up as a living sacrifice. When the Bible uses language like this, we've got to remember that every time there's a sacrifice being spoken of, you can't talk about sacrifices without talking about an altar, because a sacrifice would need to be prepared and laid on an altar. So when the Bible is now saying, well, Old Covenant, Old Testament, sacrifice, probably a cow, a goat, a lamb, whatever. New Covenant, John, Jack, Elizabeth, you and I, Meshach, Danny, maybe. Naomi, definitely. Don't feel sorry for him. Please, trust me. If the shoe was on the other foot, he'll be doing worse than this. Our lives become the sacrifice. Living sacrifices. If we're going to be transformed, if we're going to truly become agents of transformation, how many of us are willing to lay our lives down? It says, this is welcome to transformation. I know we quickly rush to the bit where it then says, you know, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. But the first part there says, hey, living sacrifice. The commitment to transformation needs a living sacrifice that is laid on the altar and is not going to move. The problem with the living sacrifice is this. A living sacrifice is no problem driving through the altar and then passing on. It says, stay. And when the sacrifice would be laid in the Old Testament, it is at that point they would call for the fire of God to consume the sacrifice. But in our churches today, we're calling for the fire of God to come, and yet there is no sacrifice for it to consume. And then we wonder, Lord, we need your fire. And he says, I am ready to bring it down, but there is no sacrifice. Yeah, but Lord, I'll touch the altar and then I'll move on. No. The sacrifice needs to be laid on the altar. And you don't move until the fire of God comes and consumes everything. We've just said we are being authentic to Christ. So we don't move from the altar until Christ can look into us and see himself. How does that happen? When you and I stay on the altar and we say, Father, I'm not moving. This is painful. This hurts. Everything in me wants to go and do something else and move in this direction. But I'm a living sacrifice and I am laying on the altar and I'm not moving. Fire of God, come and consume this living sacrifice. When the fire of God consumes our lives, we then resemble Jesus. We are truly transformed. Any takers? Are you with me? Hey, listen, I wish I'd brought a more happy, clappy word. But actually, with what our world needs right now, we need to do some house cleaning of our own. To be transformational and not conforming. Number two. To withhold nothing from God. If we're going to be authentic to Christ, we've got to be a people who withhold nothing from God. Remember, we are following a model. So here's the model. John 3:16. The Father gave his only Son. And he says, anyone who's going to believe in him shall be what? Will not. But, okay, so the Father did not withhold his Son. We're following the blueprint. 1 John 3:16, the Son did not withhold his life. He gave up his life. So the Father gave his Son, his only Son. The Son gave up his life. Where did we get this whole idea of withholding from God? And he says, if we're really doing the work on authenticity, Transformation, not conforming. But this is a big one. Withhold nothing. God, I'm going to give you 80% of everything concerning me, but, you know, let me take care of this 20. God, I'll give you my finances. You can take all the money. Generously. But, you know, I need to manage my time, Lord. I need to give my time to this. What is it that you're finding yourself withholding from God? Whew. Anything that you withhold from God can become an idol in our lives. Genesis chapter 22 is a classic opportunity, a classic moment where we see Abraham having a moment with God. Are you ready? Genesis chapter 22, verse 12. And do not reach out with the knife in your hand against the little boy, and do nothing to harm him. For now I know that you fear God with reverence and profound respect, since you have not withheld from me your son, your only son of promise. You remember that story? And God says, this moment is significant because I recognize that in your heart, the most precious thing, if God had asked for Abraham's life, he would have had it, no problem. But the most precious thing to Abraham was Isaac, the son. And the Lord said, now I know, now I see where you stand with me, because you were willing to give up even the most precious thing to you. Understanding that authenticity is about withholding nothing from God. I ask you again, what have you been withholding from God? And be honest with yourself, write it down. Because when you go back into your prayer time alone, bring that stuff before God. What is it, your children? You know, I used to do that. I was like, God, you know, these children are so precious to me. Like, I just told you my testimony, right? But can I be honest? There are moments where I'm like, okay, God, you know what? I'll give you everything else in my life. But man, these children are so precious to me. Let me brood over them. And I had to remember that the very thing I am trying to withhold from him, he's the one who's giving it to me. I want to say this to you. And remember this. Every time you think about, or even think about withholding anything from God, remember this. Satan will make a feast out of anything I withhold from God. Satan makes a feast out of anything I withhold from God. Because anything that has not been given to God becomes exposed. Whether it's your children, whether it's your finances, whatever we withhold from God becomes exposed. And the enemy can make a meal out of everything that is withheld from God. Because he recognizes that in God's DNA, remember the father gave his only son, the son gave his only life. He knows that all in matters to God. When we give all of ourselves, that matters to God. So for Satan, when we withhold something, he will use that and say, well, you've got 99% of Julia's life, but I still got the 1%. There's still this one thing. And I know, God, you want all of Julia, because in your DNA, you don't do anything in half measures. You give all. So if God has given us his all, why do we struggle to give him our all? And lastly, and then we're going to pray. Last point. Authentic followers of Christ live in the power of the Holy Spirit. So we said we're about transformation, not conforming. That's hard work. Laying on the altar as a living sacrifice. Seeing the power of God come and consume our lives. Authentic followers withhold nothing from God. We give everything. Everything is given to him. Our whole lives are his. Do you think I wanted to move up north? Really? I've always lived in the south all my life. I lived in Devon, beautiful Devon. I would have coffee in the kitchen and overlooking the sea. And he says, now move to Southampton. And I moved to Southampton, fairly coastal, but now, I mean, it's different. And then from Southampton, Manchester, Rainchester. Literally, I mean, rained every single day. Do you think that I wanted that? But when you say yes to him, yeah, even the things that you might not necessarily pick up for yourself, you do. Because you're committed to being authentic. He gave everything, and we give our all. So if we're going to live in the Spirit, Luke chapter 11 tells us exactly what we need to do. It just simply says, ask. 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 So if we're going to do things in chronological order, we would start here. We ask. And it's not just once off. When you read it, it says, continually and persistently ask for the Holy Spirit. He's the one who enables us to take the posture of withholding nothing from God. Because he reveals to us the very reasons why we can't afford to withhold anything from God. The Bible says he gives a witness to Jesus. So when that is bubbling up on the inside of us, we begin to understand the greatness, the grandeur of God, and within our hearts becomes this passion to withhold nothing from God. And when we take that position, transformation is inevitable. We become people of transformation. So over the next few moments, maybe you asked for the Holy Spirit 5 months ago, 5 weeks ago, I don't know, but we need to ask for the Holy Spirit today. Is that okay? Just going to spend the next few moments just ask for the Holy Spirit for yourself. Lord, I need you. Today, because there's no way I can genuinely withhold nothing in my own strength, I need the power of the Holy Spirit. There is no way I can actually become a person of transformation in my own strength. I need the power of the Holy Spirit. There is no way I can lead my family. There is no way I can lead myself well. I need the power of the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, the church is just another charitable organization. True transformation doesn't come just through the things that we would do to serve our communities. True transformation comes when the power of the Holy Spirit touches a man's heart and a woman's heart and brings them into a place where they fall in love with Jesus. One of the reasons why we tire when it comes to asking for the Holy Spirit is because maybe we've lost an appetite for him. Maybe I can ask a few times, but what would it look like if there was a desperation again in our hearts that says, I can't live without you. So I'm going to ask again, and I'll keep asking for you because I recognize that my life without you is incomplete. Therein lies the power. Therein is the moment we become authentic to Christ. Let me finish with this. One of the things I want to pray for is that we'll have a revelation of our need for the Holy Spirit today. Because this is what happens. A revelation of our need for the Holy Spirit will lead to a desperation for him. The only time you become desperate for something is when you recognize your need for it. And maybe that's the starting point, because we have lost the revelation of our need for the Holy Spirit. And maybe we just think, oh, we can do this Christian thing without the Holy Spirit. But if we're going to be authentic to Christ, church, we need the Holy Spirit. A revelation of our need for the Holy Spirit will lead to a desperation for Him. That desperation is what keeps you on your knees. And you keep asking, Lord, I can't understand what's happening in my family. My children have lost their way, and I keep asking. I'm staying here because I'm desperate. I'm desperate. I'm staying here. I'm desperate. I'm staying here. I'm desperate. If you'd like to stand with me, please do. If you'd like to be on your knees, you can. Those of you who might need to remain seated, you're more than welcome to whichever posture you want to take. But I just really want to encourage you to take this moment. Cultivate desperation. Lord, give us a revelation. What does it mean? What does the Holy Spirit mean to me? Or at least, what should He mean to me? I mean, even Jesus tried to paint that picture for us, to just give, at least help us to understand why we need the Holy Spirit. John 16, verse 7. And Jesus says this to them. He says, but I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage. It is your advantage that I go. Because if I do not go, then the Holy Spirit, the helper, the comforter, the advocate, the intercessor, the counselor, the strengthener, the standby, He will not come to you. But if I go, I will send Him. It is to your advantage, church. It is to our advantage to lean into the Holy Spirit. To lean into the Holy Spirit. I don't know what realities you're faced with right now. But I know that He knows. If Life Church Bedworth is to be known for one thing, may it be known for the presence of God. Because from that place, all of these other wonderful things that we can do, it will just naturally flow. They will come. The impact in our community, all of those things will come. That's a no-brainer. But if we prioritize that over the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit, we've missed it. We're doing all of that in our own strength. Holy Spirit, in this moment, we ask. Lord, I pray that there be a desperation that will arise in all of our hearts in this moment, that will result from a revelation of our need for You. Holy Spirit, we need You in our youth. Holy Spirit, we need You in our kids. Holy Spirit, we need You in our families. Jesus.
Fill our hearts with your love, surround us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love, surround us. Overflow in this place, fill our hearts with your love, surround us.
Might. It's not by power. It's by my spirit, declares the Lord. Father, would you cultivate a desire for more of your Holy Spirit in each of our lives so that we might not conform any longer to the patterns of this world, but we would be conformed to the image of your Son, Jesus Christ. We want to look like you. We want to sound like you. We want to see what you see. We want to feel what you feel. But we can't do that in and of ourselves. We need your Holy Spirit. So fill your church afresh with your Holy Spirit, we pray. Fall afresh on us. Not just for the sake of a performance on a Sunday, but for the purpose you've called us to. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. To be lives that encounter others in a way that brings them into the presence of Jesus. Help us, Lord, to desire more of you. In order to be used more by you for your kingdom cause, we pray. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. There's no real way of ending meetings like this morning. someone to stand with you and just pray that you would have an increased awareness of the Holy Spirit, increased experience of the Holy Spirit in your life. Then at the end of our time together, the prayer area over here to your right will be open. Some of our prayer team will be there, and people would love to stand with you, pray with you, pray into some of the stuff going on in your world that you might need the presence of the Holy Spirit for. Why don't we just show our appreciation to Pastor Michette for a brilliant, brilliant word. Thank you, Michette. Outstanding. Our kids are going to be let out of their cages in just a minute and come back and join us. But before they come back in, just to let you know that next, what am I announcing, Naomi? I've forgotten all. What am I meant to be mentioning? We've got Christmas coming. I know that. Christmas choir. If you want to be part of the Christmas choir, there we go. Christmas choir is coming. So there are spaces for you to be available, to be involved in our Christmas services that are coming up. Also, just to mention, Sunday the 3rd of December. That's the one I was looking for. Sunday 3rd of December. We got dedication Sunday. We're going to be dedicating some of our children. So if you would like your child to be dedicated, then come and see us at the connections point before you leave in our foyer. And we'd love to pray over your wonderful child or children on that morning. Also, if you're new here, we're so glad you're here, aren't we, church? And we want to get to know you better. So again, head to our connections area in the foyer. We'd love to take your details, let you know a little bit about what goes on in the life of the church here. And we've got a goodie bag for you to take home that will give you some more information about who we are, with some gifts in it as well. It's been a good day to be in the house, hasn't it, church? If you need to go, I realize that it's 12:29, but we're going to finish by singing one final song together. Oh, I'm taking you by surprise, am I? Let's stand together. Let's do all in, hey? Michette spoke about going all in, not just offering a little bit of ourselves to the Lord, but surrendering all of ourselves as living sacrifices. So we're going to finish with that song. If you need prayer at the end, head over to our prayer station to the right. Come on, let's stand together.
Every
pray that we will push into seeking your presence more in this week ahead. And God, I pray that you will bless each and every single one of us as we leave here today. In Jesus' name, amen.